Well, good afternoon, everybody, or whatever appropriate greeting for the time zone you are in around the world. Another fantastically, I'd hate to say attended, because I don't know yet, but registered event today. So really thrilled to see how many people. No surprise, given that it's such an interesting and topical topic. And in a nod towards a return to normality or some kind of normality, we're actually broadcasting this from a real office today, which is fantastic, as are some of our guests today. So, you know, hopefully we'll all be seeing each other in the flesh as well. But a really interesting topic today we're going to talk about. I'm sure many of you, if not all of you, will be aware of what has been happening here in the UK and also around the world with regards to stress tests for climate change risk, looking at climate biennial exploratory scenarios, looking at what's going to be happening with the representative concentration pathways, you know, towards increasing climate, increasing temperature by 2050, and in particular, what does that mean for modeling? So many of us are familiar with the history of modeling. You know, most models, from catastrophe models up until now, have been backward looking. Now we've got the challenge of how do those models or other sets of data get used to be able to look at how insurance companies and others, of course, can define and mitigate their exposure to climate risk, particularly talking about flood today. So we've got a tremendous group of people joining us. Currently, you are hopefully seeing on your screen Matt Jones from NASDAQ. Matt, good afternoon.
Hi, hi, Matthew.
Andy Smith, one of the co-founders of Fathom.
Hi, Matthew, and hi, everyone.
And Tom Philp of, Tom, I've got his right this time, Maximum Information, who's going to give us benefits of his experience from both sides of the equation, working at an insurance organization and now helping organizations. So delighted, thank you to both Fathom and NASDAQ for supporting this. And we're going to be joined by Natalie in about 20 minutes, also giving us some perspective from the Fathom point of view on models. So just some guidance for those of you who haven't joined us before or have joined us and have forgotten how this works. Very much welcome your questions. We're typically getting about between 10 and 20 questions for these events. We will allow some time at the end, but please do drop them in as we go and we'll pick them up. Always like to give some people a chance to sort of jump in on what's top of mind now and also give our panel a chance to show that they can answer something live as well as the discussion we prepared for. So please do send us those. The bottom of your screen, you should see some attachments. If you want to track down any of the speakers and find some of the information that we've already or they have already provided, you can find that down there as well. And then we'll follow up at the end just with what we've got happening next. But first of all, let's jump in. Andy, I'm going to go to you first of all. So you founded Fathom back in 2013. You've been building models now around the world. For anybody who wants to know more about what you've been doing beyond what we're talking about today, I would thoroughly recommend the podcast we did, not so much because I was asking the questions, but because you and Ollie gave a very great insight into what you're doing, and we'll see where you end up on the leaderboard tomorrow for the podcast, but there's some great things in there. But can you talk a little bit about what is happening just now in this area, and you know, generally, how are you thinking about how to help organizations related to assessing your climate risk through the sort of models you're providing and things you're going to be doing in the future?
Sure. I guess you've already set this up quite nicely, but it'll be news to nobody tuning in that the climate is changing. And the overwhelming consensus is that it's being driven by anthropogenic activities. And as scientists, we believe that as a climate warms, it will impact extreme events, and that's both in terms of frequency and severity. And it's these extreme events that, of course, insurers are particularly concerned with. Anyone out there in the UK, if you've been following this space, you'll have seen the findings of the Climate Change Committee a few weeks ago. And that painted frankly, a somewhat bleak picture of what we can expect with regards to extreme events. As the climate models are increasing in fidelity and getting better, they actually paint a worse picture of what's happening to many of the climate extremes that we experience in the UK. But this whole area of climate change impacts is now no longer the realm of just academics and research centers alone. We've seen over the past few years that financial regulators are becoming more and more interested in potential climate risk, and particularly the Bank of England. So the Bank of England, back in 2015, published a paper on climate risk in the UK, followed that up with the general insurance stress test in 2019. And that's now being followed by, as you mentioned, the climate biennial exploratory scenarios, or the CBES, that was published last month. So this, the CBES, what is it? It's essentially a climate stress test procedure. It's designed to explore the exposure of a select group of banks and insurers to climate risks. And as researchers, and I'm sure as practitioners, some people would have had comments and thoughts on it and criticisms. But I think it's important to point out this, the CBES itself, the guidelines state that it's very much exploratory. It's an exercise designed to help companies and regulators learn in this, this changing environment. And in principle, I think it's a good idea, actually. We're talking about inherently uncertain systems here. Extreme events, by their nature, are really rare events. We haven't observed that many of them. So there's significant uncertainty, even in trying to define the magnitude of events right now, regardless of any climate change. So even if the climate was stationary, I think that these kinds of exploratory stress tests that are not focused on observations alone would be really useful. But I want to caveat that by saying that, unfortunately, that this whole space of climate impact modeling is really juvenile. I undertook my PhD working on exactly this this field, and that concluded just a few years ago. So that should hopefully kind of evidence how immature this space is. It really is at the edge of academic science right now. And even with all the willpower in the world, the ability to understand the impact of climate change on many of the extreme perils that insurers care about, that ability just doesn't exist yet. So I think it'll be a huge challenge for our sector as modelers in trying to respond to the requirements of regulators over the next few years.
Yeah, I know some really good points in there. And as you mentioned, these are scenarios. There's a number of scenarios in there looking at different representative pathways, which in turn lead to different temperature conditions, which of course in turn then lead to different climate effects. And as you say, they're sort of, you know, characterizing it as juvenile. It's also a reminder of sort of the volatility and uncertainty in there, which is an important part of this. So we're going to hear a bit more about this from Tom in a minute from a practical point of view. But yeah, Andy, just what are you hearing and what are you seeing with regards to the challenges that insurers are facing? Because the thing that struck me about these stress tests is it's climate change is often seen as something that's in the future. This is now, you know, really driving insurers to report, you know, within a sort of typical 12-month business cycle on metrics and what they're going to do about it. So there's a sort of urgency around these that perhaps we haven't seen before from a regulatory point of view.
In short, I think it's a huge challenge. I'll start by on a note of optimism for insurers. I think insurers have a huge advantage over the banks involved in these kinds of exercises, because the insurance industry has been building and consuming NatCat models for decades. So you would hope there's an inherent level of experience as to how you approach this problem. Nevertheless, projecting climate change impacts and future losses is a really significant challenge, again, even for academics working in this space. And I think the challenge is actually compounded by the scope of the CBES. It's really wide. It incorporates 14 physical variables, and like they range from changing rainfall to changing heat waves. So the reality is, I think, undertaking any meaningful work on such short timescales is really difficult. Unfortunately, the models required to answer, the climate condition models required to answer the range of variables set out in CBES, they just don't exist yet. And climate condition models, if you're wondering what I mean by that, it's an attempt to explicitly model the impact of a changing climate on a given physical peril. Those models are emerging. So Fathom, Natalie will talk more about this along with Matt. Fathom are building models now that are climate conditioned in the UK. Practically, I guess the model is somewhat easy to use. It's available on the NASDAQ platform, and any CAT modelers out there can use it in the way they would use any other CAT model. But I think it is really important to keep stating that even when climate condition models are available from different vendors for different perils, they'll still be practically difficult to use. And I think that principally comes down to uncertainty. You're going to have to, we'll have to in the future incorporate some measure of uncertainty into these projections, be that uncertainty with specific scenarios, so which scenarios you select, or the exploration of uncertainty within a given scenario. And unfortunately, those uncertainties can be really, really big. So in the future, how we use those models and that uncertainty in a decision-making framework, I think will pose really significant challenges.
No, thank you. So just to emphasize that fact about climate condition. So the point being that whereas in the past people might have taken a catastrophe model and adjusted frequencies of hurricane landfall, for example, because they had a view that hurricanes are going to be more active or less active, you can't really do that in an existing model. It's a much more complicated process you've got to go through. And then the uncertainty one is an interesting one. We might pick on this a little bit as we go through and talk to Tom, but I suspect partly what the regulators are going to be looking at is how people approach the problem. So it's almost acknowledging that uncertainty and what people are doing around the boundaries and you're looking at different scenarios, as opposed to coming up sort of purely single or deterministic view. But that's really helpful. I just want to sort of, Matt, bring you into the discussion just now. So with NASDAQ, you're providing access to a number of models out there. You've got the NASDAQ modeling for catastrophe or risk modeling for catastrophes platform out there. I know many people are aware of this, but I also know that some are not. So could you just explain at sort of high level for those that aren't familiar with NASDAQ, what are you doing and how are you collaborating with other modeling companies such as Fathom?
Yeah, sure, Matthew, absolutely. So as you say, we have a cat risk modeling platform. It's called NASDAQ Risk Modeling for Catastrophes, or NRMC. And it's a multi-vendor software as a service platform based on the OASIS loss modeling framework. So a few bits in that. What it ultimately means is that people can easily access many different cat models from many different model vendors using just one platform, one user interface. And to me, that's a fundamentally good thing for the industry, because it means that people can have a very wide choice of models available to them, and they can very easily change models or add models. Before this sort of thing was available, if you wanted to access a new range of models from another vendor, you needed to change platform. And that need for a different platform really did act as a barrier, I think, to the adoption of a broad range of models. And we've essentially removed that barrier. So, we have 12 vendors on the platform right now, including Fathom, of course. We've got over 300 country perils covered. So UK flood would count as one country peril, too, if you include storm surge. So we have 300 different country perils covered amongst the 12 vendors out there. And the whole platform, like I said, is delivered as a service. It's software as a service solution. What that means is there is no on-premise install at all. There's no hardware to deploy. There's no software to install. It means you just need access to a web browser and for us to give you permission, and you can access this range of models from a range of providers. And the thing that actually makes this possible is the OASIS loss modeling framework. So we only deploy OASIS-based models. I'm sure some people on now know about OASIS, some don't. But if you don't know about OASIS, the OASIS loss modeling framework, I suggest you look it up. It's basically an industry sort of funded entity, a nonprofit entity, an open source entity, and it acts as a kind of standard for building and deploying CAT models. So, like I said, it's all open source, the code's on GitHub. And as long as the model is in OASIS format, we can deploy it. We can deploy any OASIS-based models. These can be models from other vendors. They could be models you build yourselves. As long as it's OASIS, we can deploy it. So what that means actually from a business perspective is if I put myself in the shoes of a catastrophe risk manager, that was a role I had for a number of years, this means I can supplement my view of risk really easily now, whether this is gap fill, whether it's alternative views for peak perils, whether it's a new business opportunity that's come in a new area and I haven't actually got a model for that area. We can deploy a new model to someone on the platform in a matter of hours, certainly within a day. So if there's a business need for a model, we can respond really quickly to that now. And I think that is a really important thing for the industry. I think it's a fundamentally new thing for the industry as well. So that's a little bit about what we do, Matthew.
Great. Now, we had a slide that flashed up. I wasn't quite sure if you flashed it up for some subliminal advertising. But let's bring that back up again, because you want to show that you had some...
Yeah, well, I didn't mean to flash it up. I think it was flashed up.
We'll bring it back next, because we've got time to read it. And you can see that Fathom genuinely are on your platform in there. Do you just want to talk us, just in like 15, 20 seconds, what we're actually looking at on here?
Yeah, absolutely. Like I said, we have 12 different vendors on the platform. And, related to the topic today, climate-related perils, you know, there are a number of providers with perils that cover flood and storm and hails, climate related perils. And I think, you know, related to the topic today, it's fair to say that a number of those vendors with climate related perils will be considering how they can support their customers in quantifying physical climate risk. The area is just so topical now. You know, if you're not thinking about doing that, you are missing out on an opportunity, I think. So generally, I do expect to see more climate condition cat models on our platform over the next 12 months or so. I think that's self-evident. That said, Fathom are the first vendor to release climate condition cat models on our platform. And that was the point of the slide, really. So if you could put that up, please, Matthew, that'd be great. What I wanted to show really was that these models are there. They exist on the platform. They're not vaporware, they're actually produced. And actually the slide that that I gave you, Matthew,
Matt, I'm afraid I managed to, my fat fingers and technology, I managed to delete it entirely. So
did you? Okay. Well, if people are watching, just move back a minute or so to that slide. What that showed,
You might get it back, don't worry.
Fair enough. We'll see if that can happen. But what that actually showed is a real environment. It's Fathom's user acceptance testing environment, their UAT environment. It's the environment we stand up for Fathom in our system to enable them to test the model before we deploy it to others. And what that slide shows, there we go, is the models in that environment. So I just wanted to prove the models existed. It's not just nice talk, they actually exist. And like I say, it's the first time we've had climate condition cat models on our platform. So you can see there are different models. This is a select model screen. So you put your portfolio in, you've got a range of models you can select, and you can see there the different climate conditions cat models on our platform. And you can see there the acronyms relating to different seabed scenarios, EA early action, LA late action, NAA no additional action, and the different time periods there. I'm sure we'll cover those later on. And it proves the point, you can have different models for different climate change scenarios here, or indeed different versions for the same peril. So climate, so sort of change analytics is really easy on the platform because you can have different versions stood up on the same platform at the same time. And I think, as Andy said earlier, these models are pretty easy to use. They're probably hard to produce in a sensible way. I'm sure we'll hear about that more later. But as from a user perspective, it's just the same as running any other cat model, right? You just pick the one you want to meet the timescale and the scenario you want. So, you know, the Bank of England have been quite prescriptive in what they've asked for: gross AEL, or average annual loss, gross 100-year aggregate exceedance probabilities, a district level for the UK perils, including flood. And of course, all of those metrics you can get from the model just as you can get from other cat models. So you can actually get the numbers out and fill in the spreadsheets quite easily. You know, what sits behind those is a more complicated discussion, I think. But you know, in conclusion, it's a first for us to have these climate condition models on the platform, which I think is great. I think it's fantastic that Fathom have been able to produce them so quickly.
Great, and thanks to Arena, who's sitting here helping me out when I managed to break things. Arena is here fixing them rapidly. And Matt, we've got a question for you coming in. So on Oasis, so the question is that a worldwide open source platform or is it UK only?
No, there's no geographical limitations at all. It's completely open source and able to be accessed by anyone and used by anyone around the world. So there's no limitations. Like I said, we have 12 vendors. They're all around the world. You know, Fathom are based in the UK, others aren't, and we have models for all around the world. So it's absolutely able to be sourced by anyone globally. Yeah.
Great. And then Andy, just on that geographical one, when you're looking at how you climate condition models, I know we're going to speak to Natalie a bit about this, but how different are the way models perform or develop globally that actually is a meaningful impact, and how might people look at the future climate risk?
That's a great question, because if you look at the flood models we produce for current conditions, in terms of accuracy and precision, they vary widely depending on where you are in the world. We can build, frankly, much better models in data-rich areas like the UK, as opposed to an area like Africa or even Southeast Asia. And that's somewhat specific to flood, but that problem is amplified if you look at future projections, and that's namely down to the availability of climate models around the world. In the UK, we're really lucky. We have the UK Climate Impact Project, and they produce models at increasing resolutions. So we use the 12-kilometer resolution climate model to climate condition our flood model, and we're seeing actually that there's going to be a progression to even finer resolution models in the not too distant future. And those are the resolutions at which you can really begin to resolve the kinds of physical processes that result in the rainfall that produces flood risk. Globally, we're restricted to global climate models, and applying those in a meaningful way for floods specifically is a really big problem. So it's far more uncertainty, far more challenges outside of data-rich areas like the UK.
Yeah, thanks. So Mac, coming back to you on this question about uncertainty that Andy mentioned earlier on, I mean, it's hard enough trying to model catastrophic risk if you're really just looking at what's happened as you go and look forward, as Andy explained, you have so much more uncertainty in there. You know, from your perspective, you've got a bunch of different experiences and skills that play into this. You're an actuary, you've run teams running catastrophe models for a major insurance company. You're now running NASDAQ. I mean, if we can sort of try and condense this down to a short but helpful answer, you know, what's your guidance to people as they try to grapple with this uncertainty and how they respond to these stress tests?
Yeah, I think you're right, Matthew, in saying that uncertainty in cat models is no new thing. I think the most accessible paper on this actually is the Guy Carpenter paper in 2011, where they looked at US hurricane risk. And just to give people that aren't aware of the level of uncertainty in these models an idea, they basically concluded for a well-modeled peril like US hurricane, if you think about the 100-year return period, if you take the number coming out of a model for that, for a nationwide portfolio, and you halve it and you double it, you've got about a 2/3 chance that the real answer is somewhere in that range. You know, you're not talking about small percentages when you're talking about uncertainty. And sometimes that surprises people. And that's not considering climate change, right? That's just like you said, backwards looking models. And so what that means is, as sort of practitioners in the field, we've developed ways of dealing with that uncertainty. And so there's some things that can help. I think developing a view of risk, understanding how the model's been developed, applies to climate change condition models even more so than it does historical models. I think including input from multiple models, as long as that's done in a careful way, can be useful. I think ranges are really important. I mean, you have to give almost in all situations, you have to give point numbers. And this, from what I've seen of the CBES templates, that's no different. But communicating the uncertainty about those in terms of ranges is useful, because then what you can do is you can think of the business consequences of different of valid numbers within those ranges. So, you know, if the number's this, what does that mean to my strategy, my business decisions? If the number's that, what does that mean? And I think that's a really important thing, making sure that business decisions understand the fact point numbers aren't that's not the right answer. It's a range around those point numbers that's true. I think the other thing to say is, although the absolute uncertainty might be really big, when you look at differences or deltas, that can be helpful. If you're looking to know if I move my portfolio in this direction or that, how does that compare to my current, and look at differences, that can sometimes remove biases because you're differencing things, and that can be helpful. So I think with climate change, there's more uncertainty. Clearly, climate models are not climate scientists, but I'm sure they won't agree. So when you try and factor that into this, there's bound to be more uncertainty looking forwards. And I think it's just people need to realize these are directional order of magnitude changes rather than precise figures in the way we use them. I think it's just realizing that's really important. But I mean, ultimately, you sometimes just need to fill in a template with a number, right? And that's what these tools enable you to do, even if you very much need to recognize the uncertainty around them.
Yeah, although that point about change, particularly, I mean, I know these are biennial, meaning every 2 years for the stress test, but I mean, the PRA, Lloyds, other regulators are, you know, looking at the capital requirements on an annual basis. So I think we're going to see that very much come to the fore about what the relative measures are. But Tom, definitely time to bring you into conversation now. Lots of things we've touched on that I know you have got personal experience with in your time at AXA XL when you ran the science side of the business. I'm sure the title was more elegant than that. But essentially, you were looking and evaluating models. Now you're out there helping organizations and insurance companies actually address exactly this kind of thing. So can you just maybe just start us off a bit more about, you know, what you are doing with Maximum Information, and then I just, you know, start to get into the practical ways that insurance companies can get their head around some of these answers that we've been discussing.
Sure, yeah, thanks for having me. I'll be really brief on that. So I think my experience in the industry after leaving academia about 8 years ago has just shown me how I think there's a lot of bridges being built between academia and the industry in this catastrophe risk and increasingly this climate risk space. But there's still a lot of holes and a lot of gaps. And I saw that there's a big opportunity for some good private work on targeted analytics that help bridge that gap more quickly between, I would say, not only academia, but potentially model vendors and model users ultimately. But at the same time, there's also big gaps on the academic side where I think a lot of the catastrophe modeling that's done in the industry is really, as Andy was saying, with particularly in this climate space, is really cutting edge. And a lot of the coherent flow of information from the hazard right through to the vulnerabilities and loss actually is missed by a lot of academic disciplines, I think. And there's a potential large amount to learn there. So while I've set up a targeted private analytics company on the one hand, it also has a not-for-profit arm where we're trying to, I'd say, facilitate the communication of the questions and the research from the catastrophe risk side out to universities so that everybody is helping on this journey.
Well done doing that. I mean, that's what struck me looking at some of the sort of recommendation guidance, you know, as Matt termed it, for filling in forms, is that, the academic side is probably stronger on the hazard risk, whereas it comes to the vulnerability and joining everything up, it seems to be a little bit more limited. And I think also to some of the earlier points about insurance companies are actually further ahead than banks just because they've been looking at probabilistic analysis for a while. But these are the second CBES. So the first ones came out in 2019. Can you just talk a little bit about the differences and also what in your experience in the last, it's really in the last month or so, but people knew these were coming. How seriously do you think the senior executive and the boards of insurance companies take these? Do they really appreciate the significance of what this means and actually how difficult it is, but how important it is to get it right?
Yeah, that's a really tough question to unpick. So a good one though, right? So I think the people that have got sight of the full 2021 scenario documents are taking it as seriously as they need to. That's my experience. The evolution of this from the 2019 ones, which I would sort of describe as purely, and the PRA did state this in the paper, that they were exploratory scenarios, right? They were very sort of niche, certain aspects of certain perils, but really just trying to explore the area. It's changed massively from that. This is no longer exploratory. There's two really key features that I think the PRA are trying to get out of this. On the one hand, it's a impact to balance sheet across the board. So really coherent across all perils. And in the insurance case, that would be all peril regions for physical risk. But then all of the sort of transition risk impacts on your assets and then your litigation potential impacts that come along as well, and at multiple time horizons on multiple different emission scenarios. This is a huge amount of work and a big change and shift from what's gone before, and a lot of challenges that come with it, right? So Andy hinted at this before. I'm really supportive of the philosophy of what they're trying to drive at here, this shift towards, I guess, a forward-looking view rather than a backwards-looking view when we're, I guess, more and more moving into an uncertain climate and a not seen before climate. But that's not to say that the way that the questions have been framed and the exercise has been put to insurers, it's not to say that it's perfect. So it's going to be challenging trying to extract meaningful information, I think, from the way it's set up at the moment. But it's a necessity, right? It has to happen like this.
Yeah, and to some extent, I suppose it has to offer sort of a way forward for people that aren't experienced in this, but also allow for the more sophisticated modelers. And there's a question that's coming that actually was aimed at Matt, but I think, Tom, I'm going to ask you this question more broadly. So the question for Matt was, are the 12 models on the, on NASDAQ through to the OASIS platform supported by the Bank of England? And just so people understand, we talk sort of probably Bank of England and the PRA sort of synonymously. So Tom, what is the view of the PRA or the Bank of England in terms of which models are being used? Have they come out yet and been prescriptive about which ones are acceptable, or are they looking really more at people to make their own judgments?
Yeah, it's the latter, fully the latter. So it gets to that second point that a big part of this is the building capability of the firms to actually understand and report on the risk. So they're not looking to get a model vendor to provide a solution as such. They're looking to actually challenge the direct insurers to go out and fully understand the problem. That will obviously take a lot of interaction with lots of vendors. But yeah, it's not to say that they've got specific vendors that are solving certain problems here. That's not the way it's being looked at.
And then just again, from a practical point of view, for people listening who are wondering how on earth they're going to tackle all of this and the timescales, or, you know, this is at the moment, it's only with a selected number of insurance companies, but it's quite likely it's going to roll out more broadly. With all the different, you know, we've got the various different representative concentration pathways leading to different temperatures. There's different types of transitions from orderly to disorderly to sort of panic at the last minute. How, again, asking you a lot to summarize in a relatively brief way, but maybe you feel free to point to something else you can follow up with people. Where should organizations start with this? It's a lot to tackle and get their head around, and there's different levels of expertise out there.
Yeah, that's really tough, right? I think there's a number of challenges that you have to sort of get yourself through right off the bat. Andy hinted at one of them earlier. It's this problem with climate modeling in the way that it's set up, I think, for, you know, doing the actual physics-based climate runs, effectively produces these gridded continuous variables for, you know, key things like temperature and lots of other variables. That doesn't connect in any way to the way that catastrophe modeling has been built over the last 40 or so years. So you have these continuous physical variables on the one hand coming from academia, and on the other hand, you have these event-based historical observation-driven risk sets, effectively. And making that leap is extremely difficult. And it's not likely to be solved in a few months, which is effectively what the seabed scenarios currently are requiring. So people have to, I think, on the one hand, try and look at the scenarios in their key peril regions and work out where those leaps might have been made by model vendors at the moment. I think a few are starting to make them, if not fully, they're at least on the way. And obviously Fathom are on that path for the flood side. But it's not likely that the model vendors will have solved all of those things themselves. So there's a lot of qualitative leaps that I think people are going to have to make. And a good one actually is on the emission scenarios themselves. So even before you've got to this leap between the physical climate models and the event-based loss modeling, the emission scenarios that are laid out by the CBES are the early policy, late policy, no policy action, which is typical of the policy conversation. That doesn't really connect very well or very often to the scientific research on the actual peril regions themselves, which are done in the more representative concentration pathway, which most people will know is like RCP 2.5, 4.5, 8.5. And effectively, those two different things mean different temperature things at different times. And so you may not have results for a certain peril region that match up with the emission scenario coming from the policy side. So not only do you have to think about a sort of layer down and making qualitative leaps about the climate to event loss-based modeling, but before that, you even have to make qualitative leaps about the policy scenarios to the scientific RCP scenarios. So I think it's about trying to understand. The people that have to report on this is about trying to understand that chain, see it very clearly, and work out how they're going to report and make those qualitative leaps. And then there's a final thing that really comes from this. I think one of the things we have to understand as an industry and get very good about communicating this is that we're not reporting risk here. We're reporting changes in hazard, right? We've been told to isolate off effectively the exposure and vulnerability components for the largest part in these exercises and only report on changes in the hazard, which is just not true. It's not going to happen. So it's ultimately a lesson in potential mitigation adaptation strategies. It's not a comment on future risk. But my big fear, I think, with a lot of this is that people will see it as a comment on future risk. And so I think on the one hand, as Matt said earlier, the templates are there. You'll have to put in precise numbers, and they are effectively meant to be pushing the envelope numbers. But probably the biggest challenge I see for most insurers is, while you have to make all of these very big qualitative leaps to do this, the bigger challenge is actually controlling the overall narrative to make sure it's well understood by the people that are digesting that information at the end of it, that you're not really reporting on future risk. You're just reporting on a theoretical scenario if things go that way. So lots to think about, lots to manage.
Yeah, thanks, Tom. A lot to take in there. And just for all of you out there that are furiously taking notes, just to give you something to look forward to, we will be writing this up and returning to you in a few days, maybe a week or two, the write-up from this as well. So you'll see what we've been discussing. Tom, we'll come back to you in a few minutes. Lots more to talk about, but I want to bring Natalie on now. So Tom, if you can push the magic button and disappear, and Natalie, hope you can find the magic button to bring you on board. Just whilst we're doing that, it'll be great, fantastic. Thanks for all the questions coming in. We've got some really good ones here. We're probably going to take these towards the end. And if we don't get to all your questions, then we will be passing these on to the panelists to get back to you on those. So Natalie, welcome. You are Senior Climate Change Expert at Fathom. Can you just give us your very quick elevator story of what that means in practice?
Hi, yes, thank you for having me. So I've worked for quite a few years in academia as a climate modeler. So I've researched everything from how we can model tropical cyclones to how climatic extremes may change over the coming century. And so my role at Fathom is really to develop our climate portfolio. So we'll be using data from kind of state-of-the-art climate models to try and understand how precipitation might change in the future and how this will impact inland flooding and cyclones. And the aim is to develop kind of global data products that will allow us to account for future changes in climate in a way that's flexible and transparent, but most importantly, that's research-led and really in line with the science and where academia is right now.
Brilliant. Natalie, I might ask you to lean a little bit further forward towards your computer. I might understand. It's good, but if we can just get a little bit sharper, it'd be great. And then we're going to talk, we've just sort of talked generally about what's happening with climate condition models, but can you just talk a little bit of the specifics for people that want to sort of get under the hood or under the bonnet of what that means in practice when you take a model like Fathom and start to use it for looking forward?
Absolutely. So a climate condition model is one where the outcome is linked to one or more physical climate variables or hazards. So that may, for example, be extreme rainfall or cyclones or heat waves. And traditionally, these models have been conditioned on present-day climate because we have observations for present-day climate, and that data has been most appropriate, obviously, for conditions as they are. But as the climate changes, flood risk projections, for example, that are based on current climate conditions will become increasingly outdated. And so projections of future climate changes are going to need to be incorporated into these models. And just as an example, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change estimates that a one-day precipitation event with a frequency of 1 in 20 years under current climate could become a 1 in 10-year event in the future. And so models need to be conditioned to kind of represent this change in hazard so that the changing risk can then be assessed.
Okay, no, that's very helpful. And then you touched on this just in your introduction there, and we generally, when we talk about, or people talk about climate change risk, it's regarding sea surface level increases. We talk a little bit about flooding, rain, but can you just talk us through the different ways that this is going to impact, you know, flooding, you know, and maybe for those that aren't familiar with the terms pluvial, fluvial, and the distinction between coastal, just to kind of explain how the different floods can manifest themselves.
Absolutely. So flooding, as you've kind of alluded to, can arise from a number of different sources. So this could include extreme river flows, rainfall, and coastal water levels and waves. And so it's really important that the models that we're building represent all of these processes. So the pluvial processes, which are associated with kind of extreme, very heavy rainfall events, fluvial, which covers river flow, and then coastal flooding, which can be a result of sea level rise generally, but also when tropical cyclones hit an area, it results in a storm surge, which kind of pushes seawater further inland due to the action of winds. And a tropical cyclone, for example, may result in all of these types of flooding. So you get heavy rainfall, which will result in peak river discharge and then a storm surge. So you do need to really represent all of these processes in your floods to kind of accurately model inland and coastal flooding. And so the Fathom UK model, for example, we've included all of these processes. So that's fluvial, pluvial and coastal processes to kind of really account for how the overall picture of flood hazard might change under current or future climate scenarios. And so the scenarios that we've looked at for the future cover the 2030, 2050 and 2070 time horizons. And as Andy's mentioned already, they're conditioned on the Met Office's UK climate projections or UK CPA team 2018 climate data, which I believe is also what the CBES scenarios have been based on or have used. We've modelled two different emission scenarios, so RCP 2.6 and 8.5, to kind of give a range of potential trajectories for how climate and flood risk might change in the future. And then, as Matt's already presented, we've also produced a set of models that are appropriate for use in the CBES. So these have been specifically conditioned based on the warming scenarios and the time horizons that have been defined by the Bank of England. As he said, they're ready to be used now, and are some of the first on the NASDAQ platform.
Great, and we've got a lot of acronyms here, but hopefully people are keeping track. We're trying to keep it to limitation, but just to make sure, for anybody that's wondering what these different RCP scenarios are, essentially the ones that lead to different temperature changes relative to, I think, the beginning of the last century, wasn't it? So when you talk about different numbers or different numbers from the catalogue, that's just a way of identifying what temperature difference is going to be at future and at different points in the future. Have I characterized that correctly?
Yeah, so yes, the RCP scenarios are ones that we used in the last assessment report by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. So they define kind of low to high levels of warming. There are updated versions of those which are being used now more in academia, which kind of account for different socioeconomic global changes. And then obviously there's the NGFS climate scenarios as well, which kind of aim to model the impacts of climate change, but then also the impacts of those physical changes in climate on different sectors. So yeah, depending on what kind of climate you're wanting to look at, there are even regardless of the other uncertainties, there are a whole range of different future scenarios you could decide to implement.
Now you're just testing me, aren't you, to see how well I know my acronym. So NGFS, Network for Greening the Financial System. I get that one right?
Yeah.
And they've also provided some of the data to help people define what their future climate risk is going to be. Natalie, that was really helpful. Stay there, because we're going to bring Tom back in as well. But just whilst I'm bringing Tom back, Andy, I've just got a question for you. When we talked about this before, I believe one of the things you offer as Fathom, because partly given your own academic backgrounds, is you're quite open in terms of the research you've done and sort of helping people to understand, you know, how you've built these models and things. I'm assuming a lot of what Natalie's talking about here is just consistent with that as well, is it? And people can get access to that.
Yeah, I mean, we attempt to publish everything that we do in peer-reviewed journals. Anybody who's published stuff in peer-reviewed journals will know that that can be a pretty slow process. So we don't have everything, all the methods published yet, but if you have questions around the methods that we use, we can share those. We have documents that outline exactly how we've done everything. And we aim to get pretty much everything published in open access journals. So they're subject to peer review. So you can have faith that they've gone through some level of scrutiny. And we're as open, I think, as we possibly can be.
Brilliant. Okay, well, we've got a whole host of questions. Rina is rapidly typing away here. My eyes look like they're wandering off the screen because I'm actually reading them. So here we go. Natalie, got one for you. It's like a sort of fast fire round, this one. Is it possible to model flash flooding as a climate change? And is that part of the Fathom model?
So I think that would be covered by, my background or my area of expertise is more on the climate change side itself. So Andy might be better placed to answer this question, but I believe it is, but I will hand over to Andy.
Yeah, in the UK, we're getting there. So when we talk about flash flooding, we're often talking about things like convective rain cells, and those kinds of phenomena are not represented in global climate models. So we can look at the tail ends of precipitation distributions in climate models globally, but the reality is that lots of the mechanisms that drive flash flooding aren't represented in the climate models. There's a more optimistic picture in the UK. So the increasing fidelity of climate models in the UK means that we are really beginning to get there. with regards to the representation of extreme rainfall over really short durations. And that's kind of, I mentioned right at the beginning, the Independent Climate Change Committee and the findings that they produced a few weeks ago. And unfortunately, as these models increase in fidelity and they represent the processes that drive flash flooding in a more accurate way, they actually paint a bleaker picture. And we are really, really getting there now, actually. I think in the next few years, we'll have climate models that really do represent things like convective rain cells. So, in short, globally, no. In the UK, we're almost there.
Right, and bad news to come with more flooding. So, okay, excellent. So, Tom, one for you now. So, someone's asked a question: will the PRA be looking for smaller companies to respond in proportion to their size to the stress test? Now, I know I can't remember the exact number. You probably can tell us that this has initially only been aimed at a handful of the larger insurance companies, some are UK, some are global. There are, I believe, 10 Lloyd's syndicates have got to respond to this, but any early indications either from the PRA or, as you know, Lloyd's often follows this across all of the market of what is going to be expected of companies that fall below that sort of large company threshold?
No, I'm not sure. So while this hasn't been exploratory, I suppose it is in some way, because as you say, it's been aimed at 10 insurers, 10 banks, and then 10 syndicates within Lloyd's. I'm not sure. I think it takes a reassessment of the results of this and the feedback that the PRA get before they decide what to do, but they may well have concluded that. I think one of the things that is probably more useful to those smaller insurers that, so one of the other things that I am seeing is that while I think those big insurers already on the way of having to do this modeling and reporting on it, a lot of the smaller insurers are still being asked these questions by their investors and by their clients. And so it's still important for them to get this type of answer out and get this thinking embedded. And I think the way that they should maybe think about going about doing this is the first step, I suppose, on the process to doing the CBES physical risk thing properly is to understand your materiality to your peril regions in a number of different metrics, right? That can be gross written premium, it can be AALs, it can be your 1 in 100 TVAR, whatever it is that you want to view your risk on, but sort of rank your relative risks between them and then start thinking about, well, do we have to invest significantly to understand climate change in this space? I think that's at least the first step that gets the ball rolling.
Good, okay. And then, Tom, another question for you, which you touched on this a little bit in terms of the liability side and the sort of focus on the hazard, but someone's quite rightly pointed out that the insurers are also being asked to report on the asset side on their balance sheet. How could the panel comment on how the modelling can be helped to look at those investment risks as well as, you know, the catastrophe modelling side that we know better?
Yeah, that's the sort of golden egg question, right? I think it's going to take a lot of time to reverse engineer, I think, what these models have been used for in insurance questions and get this out. I think there are a number of things that you can do effectively, like taking the flood modeling and trying to construct an investment portfolio, looking at what effectively flood risk is going to be is a simple way of starting to think through it. But in terms of quantifying that properly and quantifying impacts to asset portfolios, like, it's beyond my experience, certainly for the time being. But I think this is a massive area of opportunity for anybody that can start to run into it.
Okay. And then, Matt, an easy one for you, hopefully. Are you offering any kind of models through NASDAQ or through OASIS that look at offshore perils for renewables? And of course, the whole transition risk to renewables is another part of this, but is there anything you can comment on what you cover there?
Yeah, we don't cover anything offshore at the moment. I'm sure that time will come. There certainly are cat models out there that cover offshore, both in the Gulf of Mexico and in North Sea platforms. But no, we haven't got platforms on, we haven't got models on the platform right now that cover offshore, but I'm sure they'll come.
Okay. And then one, so Tom, you touched on this earlier on, but just be interested to know across the insurers that are being asked to respond to this, is there a collaboration at the insurance level? You know, because this is, yeah, I would suspect, the benefit of all if they collaborate on how to do this. Are you seeing that happening, or does it tend to be more each company's doing this somewhat independently?
No, while every company has to have an independent strategy here, there is a lot of collaboration going on in the industry at the moment. the question is asked on, I suppose, in that on the particular journal space, which has always been a problem, right? So that there hasn't been an open source catastrophe modeling peer-reviewed journal. I think the only thing I can say in that thing, that there are a couple of journals that overlap, so natural catastrophes, natural hazards, I think it is, but still it's not, it doesn't get at that full chain. The only thing I can say is watch this space. I think there is some efforts within the industry at the moment to try and build that journal. And not only that, I think there's other things going on, other initiatives. So one of the initiatives I am involved with is trying to set up a climate risk research group, I think, that is trying to piece together relevant literature from the hazard side, from the vulnerability side, and that isn't competitive, I suppose, so that it can get individuals from different companies involved and all building the same, picture towards actual resilience without being competitive. So if anybody would like to get involved in that isn't already and is on the call, then please just give me a shout and I'll make sure you're linked in.
And Matt, I mean, you've got a good visibility onto that. It's been one of the reasons that OASIS was set up originally, was to provide open access to data. Are you seeing anything that, similar question to Tom, that we haven't talked about, for collaboration between different insurance companies?
No, I think OASIS is open source. It doesn't mean that every model built in OASIS is openly available to everyone. That's not what it means. It means the code base of OASIS as open source models are still proprietary. So I think every vendor's a little bit different in how open they are. Fathom do seem to publish a lot. I think that's clear. We've already covered that particular point. But no, I haven't really got much to add to what Tom said. I think there is a disconnect to some extent between the level of detail and what goes into academic papers and actually what ends up in the CAT model. But I think if firms can be more open and can publish more in peer-reviewed papers, that'll close the gap.
Good. And what about just collaboration between insurance organisations themselves, between the parties that actually are responsible for putting this together? Are you seeing anything that's happening in that area? I mean, you might not, so feel free to say no, but I just wondered if you've seen anything happening there.
I can't think of anything specific, Matthew. I'm sure there must be, but I can't think of anything specific.
Okay, not to worry. So another question for all of you, looks like someone's out there with their checkbook. So if you happen to be a company that is offering, not specifically directed to our panel, but you're offering mapping software, you might want to listen to this one. So someone's asked if there are any recommendations you'd make for people who are using models and want to be able to map those. Matt, I'm going to come back to you on that one. Feel free again to say no, but is there any sort of organizations or tools you've seen that you could point people towards that can help with mapping exposures?
Yeah, I mean, QGIS is an open source GIS package that's explicitly for mapping things. I mean, you've got to get the data in the right formatting to be able to deal with it properly, but that's an open source tool that can be used for mapping stuff, including outputs from CAT models and outputs from climate models if they're formatted in the right way. So that is a tool I'd go to. And then if you've got a bit of a coding background, then things like R can be used for mapping stuff fairly straightforwardly. So those are a couple of tools I've used a bit. I'm by no means an expert in those at all, but I've used a bit for mapping data sets and so on.
Good. Natalie or Andy, what do you want to offer some suggestions?
For my sins, I have used QGIS extensively for many years, and it would be my, if I was looking to both visualize and map exposures, but also undertake some form of analysis on that, QGIS would be where I'd go. And there are various Python toolboxes that you can plug into Q that are actually very user-friendly. It won't take you very long to be able to pull out meaningful results from those platforms. So QGIS and Python would be my go-tos for sure.
Right. I see Natalie, you're nodding. And Tom, anything you want to add to that? You've got quite good visibility out there.
No, I think the only thing that I would add is there's a number of initiatives going on in the climate space with sort of weather centers. So the big one that I can point to is just the Copernicus project. They are trying to ramp up their ability to get effectively the CMIP, so the coupled model into comparison project data that feed the IPCC assessment reports. They're trying to get toolboxes that are much more easily usable from non-scientists, I guess, to actually do this sort of mapping up and running. So if you just check out that Copernicus ECMWF website, you should be able to find links into that. I think it's it is a work in progress, but they on that side as well, they are also looking for people to try and iterate with and try and build this more risk picture, because obviously they've got the climate side. So if anybody is interested and has that appetite to try and get involved and help shape that picture of risk coming from these new CMIP models that will come out with AR6, then yeah, I'm sure they'd be all ears.
Great. Okay. And then this is like one of these and finally questions. This might be a serious question. It might be a serious scientific one. It might be one that's testing you all. But I'm going to start off with Andy on this one. Hopefully you'll be able to read the question. So someone said a recent study by the National Oceanic Atmospheric, NOAA anyway, has said that there's a moon wobble going on that could lead to increased flooding in, I think it was 2030, I've lost the question now. Andy, did you see that question, and do you have any comments on moon wobbles and impacts on increased flooding?
I will hold my hands up and say I've never heard of that. So I will immediately follow in this call. I will be having a look, but I've not heard of that, I'm afraid.
Natalie, moon wobbles, is that something that's come across your desk?
No, I know climate models certainly account for changes in the brightness of the sun, but I haven't heard of moon wobbles before.
Matt, you've got to blow, but don't worry about it, because we'll be all saying so well fairly soon. Moon wobbles, anything you've got to comment on?
Unfortunately not. That's a new one to me too.
Right, I'm guessing, Tom, you haven't heard it either in that case. Good.
For, so, for what it's worth, it would make sense, right? I mean, the moon controls the tides, so if there were any significant changes in the moon's behavior, then could have pretty significant implications. But I've not heard of it.
Just slightly different. Just coming back to the previous question you asked, one example I should have mentioned of insurance collaboration is the Insurance Development Forum. There's not time to talk about that in detail now, but please look that up, especially the risk, the RMSG, the Risk Modeling Steering Group, is something to look at. That is an example of insurance collaboration to help people sort of mitigate and respond to this sort of risk.
Good, yeah, we'll put that in the follow-up from this. Good, well, maybe somebody from the PRA is listening, and Moonwop will be in the 221, where are we now? We're on the 223 CBAS. Look out for it, and thank you for that question. So we're just coming up to the top of the hour. I just want to say thanks to all of you. Andy and Matt, I'm going to ask you to say a final few words just at the end before we wrap up. Just before we go there, though, please do look out for our next event coming up on the 20th July. Similar theme to this, although it's going to be around casualty modelling with Predicat, looking at what is happening with Lloyd's and a whole area of casualty and liability modelling and emerging scenarios. So similar theme, albeit different perils, although there is some convergence around climate risk. So, Andy, just anything we haven't covered in here, and then just in the last sort of 60 seconds we're going to give you that you think is important to bring to people's attention?
I guess I'll end on a note of caution and then optimism, because I'm an optimist. Tom made a really good point about this leap between climate models and losses. Like, how we make that leap, we're still very much in our infancy, and there's no correct way to do that. This whole space is for sure immature. So a note of caution for anybody using these models: they're new, they're juvenile, they'll give you different answers. Different providers will for sure give you different answers. But on the optimistic side, I will say that I think some level of maturity in the climate impact modeling will emerge in the next few years. Climate models are getting better, particularly in the UK. Our ability to build flood models at large scales, hopefully we can begin to converge on answers. So some caution and some optimism to wrap up.
Excellent. Matt, anything from you?
I think we're seeing the beginning, really, of a sort of new era of climate-related analytics coming out now with these climate condition models now appearing. I think they're obviously still in their infancy. There's lots of uncertainty, but I think they're the beginning of quite a big change, and the beginning also of people beyond insurers, reinsurers, and brokers using the model. I think in 10 years' time, there'll be many more people using these kinds of models to help assess their risk. So quite exciting.
Yeah, I can learn from insurance. Good. Well, thank you to all of our panelists. Thank you to Fathom and NASDAQ for our support. For all of you listening, if you are one of our corporate members, you should have received by now an invitation to our summer party on the 21st of July. And you'll see some of our panelists there. And it may have got lost in your email box if you haven't received it, if you're not a member. Or maybe you can sign up and join us for the next party. We're coming back to live events from the 14th of September back in the Steelyard face-to-face and then again on the 11th of October. So we're very excited to get everyone back together again, hopefully mask-free and socially distancing-free. But we'll be carrying on with our digital events, got more lined up, as I mentioned. Been a real pleasure, and yeah, look forward to seeing you all face-to-face. And as I said, look out for the write-up of this coming shortly. And with that, I will say goodbye. Thank you to our panelists. Farewell.
Thanks, everyone. Bye.
Thanks.